Hello everybody, welcome to NEET Crash Course. So now we shall discuss about the synopsis of the chapter Organisms and Populations. So all living organisms, as you all know, we are directly affected by the environment which we are living in because we are constantly interacting both with the living and the non-living environment. What exactly does the term environment mean? The term environment exactly means surrounding. Now, surrounding doesn't only mean the inanimate objects, it includes both living as well as non-living objects. Plants and animals are adapted to, so there are a lot of climatic fluctuations and variations that are occurring in our surrounding environment, and there are a lot of abiotic factors like air, water and soil which we are constantly adapted to. And the chapter that we are dealing with basically concerns a field of science that is called ecology, where there is a study of interrelationship among organisms, how one organism interacts with another organism, as well as how an organism interacts with its surrounding atmosphere or surrounding environment. And you know about the different components of the surrounding environment that an organism interacts with. There is atmosphere, the gaseous atmosphere, the solid, the liquid hydrosphere, and the solid lithosphere. And you know about the rotation of our planet, which creates day and night, isn't it? And also there is a tilt in our axis, in our planetary axis, and that causes alteration in intensity and duration of temperature, and that is responsible for seasons. And such annual variation in rainfall precipitation is also because of certain seasonal changes and temperature fluctuations that are happening on our planet. Regional and local variations within each biome. Now, there are not only large geographical area variations, but there are also variations which happen in a very small region or in a local environment, and that creates a variety of habitats or dwelling place for different organisms. And as you have already learned, that life can exist in extreme and harsh environmental conditions also, like in deserts, in rain-soaked Meghalaya forests, in deep ocean trenches, in torrential streams, in permafrost polar regions, in high mountain tops, in boiling thermal springs, in stinking compost pits. This tells you that life can conquer any kind of a habitat, be it hostile or be it favorable, and it adapts itself to continuously grow in that kind of a habitat. The key elements with which living organisms interact with each other, the non-living components of the environment, are referred to as abiotic components. Some of the abiotic components are temperature, water, light and soil. And then, like I told you, organisms also exhibit interaction with each other, that is called the biotic components. The biotic components like pathogens, parasites, predators and competitors. It is assumed that over a period of time, now because of natural selection is what drives a process that is referred to as adaptation, where an organism develops means in order to make maximum utilization of its available resources. And that is possible because of this evolutionary process called natural selection. There is a defined range of conditions which every organism can tolerate. Some of us can tolerate very narrow range of temperature. Like mammals and birds can tolerate a wide range of temperature, so each organism has its own tolerance limit. What are the level of ecological organization? Now, if you think about the level of biological organization, we start from the tiniest of atom and then we move on to molecules, and then we talk about an entire living organism, which may be unicellular or multicellular. But if we talk about in terms of ecological hierarchy, we start with an individual and then we move on to different levels of interaction that occur between an organism and its surrounding environment. So let us see what are the different components of ecological hierarchy, or what are the different ecological levels of organization. The first one, the most basic, is the individual or organism. Now, you as an individual, you represent the smallest level of ecological organization. You are basically a mass of atoms and biomolecules which are constantly participating in life processes which are happening inside your body. Now, this individual groups itself into what is referred to as population. There are group of similar individuals. Now many individuals which are alike come together and they occupy a particular geographical area or space. And when they occupy a particular geographical area or space, they are said to be a population. And in a population also, there are local variations that are seen over a small range. And such local variations or populations which are adapted genetically to a specific environment is referred to as ecotype. So local variations, small scale variations which exist within the population. Say for example, there is a group of plants growing at the foothills of a mountain. Now there will be a specific genetic change in these organisms because the environment there will be slightly different from say a slightly up the mountain. So then you can call such a group, a small group of population which is occupying or genetically which is adapted to a particular environment as ecotype. Then we have a biotic community or a biological community. Very, very important. The word community means it is a group of populations and where different populations come together, different species come together and they constantly interact with each other. And what does a community give rise to? A community gives rise to an ecosystem where it is not only an interaction that exists between living organisms, but community interacts even with its non-living environment. Like for example, the abiotic factors such as temperature, light, then minerals in water, soil, etc. So when there is a constant interaction that is happening between the biotic components of a community and the abiotic components, then we call it as an ecosystem. The best example of a functional ecosystem is the pond ecosystem. Then you have landscape, the unit of land that can be distinguished by its natural boundaries, and it is basically a collection of different ecosystems. So more than one ecosystem, of course, not a very large patch of land or not a very large area. Like for example, if you take the southern peninsula of India, it is not such a vast area as well. This is referred to as a landscape. But however, if the groups of ecosystems stretch over very, very large geographical area, then it is referred to as a biome. For example, you have the tundra, you have the desert, tropical rainforest, tropical deciduous forest, grassland biome, etc. Then you have biosphere, the largest unit in the level of or the highest level in the ecological organization is called the biosphere. It is the biologically inhabited part of Earth. There is a thin layer on Earth, little below the soil and above the soil and the atmosphere, which is occupied by life. The thin film of life on Earth is referred to as the biosphere. What are some of the environmental factors which directly, remember, environmental factors directly or indirectly influence the form of organisms and the functioning of organisms? And we already saw there are two major environmental factors. One is referred to as abiotic factor and one is referred to as the biotic factor. Some of the major abiotic, so by now you know that abiotic factor means non-living factor. Some of the major non-living factors, which are some of the conditions which exist in environment, say for example, temperature, humidity, availability of gases in the atmosphere, etc. And they can influence the survival of organisms, the form of organisms, how the organisms function in their surroundings, how they behave with each other, and whether they are capable of carrying out reproduction or whether there is a specific time during which there are favorable environmental factors or abiotic factors which trigger the reproductive processes and so on. This is how you can see how abiotic factors play or have a great influence on the life of plants and animals and organisms on this planet. So let us first look into temperature. You know that in polar region, the temperature shoots below, it dips below sub-zero, and then in deserts, it shoots up to 50 degrees centigrade. And you know how the temperature fluctuates from equator to the pole. So it is seen that for every 6.5 degrees, there is a rise in the latitude. You can see that. There is a decrease in every 6.5 degree temperature for every 10 degree rise in latitude. As you go away from the equator, there is a drastic fall in the temperature. Accordingly, organisms living in these zones can be classified into megatherms, mesotherms, microtherms, and hecistotherms. Urethermal organism. If an organism can tolerate a wide range of temperature, it is called urethermal. Uri refers to wide range and thermal refers to temperature. Most mammals and birds, Artemisia tridentate, which is a family belonging to the sunflower group of plants. Then you have animals or organisms which can tolerate a very narrow range of temperature tolerance. If temperature fluctuates within that, beyond that range, then they cannot lead a normal life. So those organisms which live within a very narrow range of temperature, they are called as stenothermal organisms. For example, you have polar bear, lizards, amphibians, plants, abies, spicea, some of the plants like coconut, etc. Ectothermal, you all are aware, ectothermal means the temperature depends upon the surrounding environment, so they are called poikilothermal animals like birds, plants and mammals. Endothermal means they have an inbuilt temperature control mechanism, like, you know, our hypothalamus helps in regulating our temperature. So when there is an inbuilt temperature control mechanism and your body can maintain its own temperature irrespective of the surrounding despite the changes that happen in the environmental temperature, then we are called as homeothermal, or we also have homeothermal or warm-blooded animals. I'm sorry, here bird is included under cold-blooded. Sorry, it is ectothermal, is not birds and mammals, it is reptiles and amphibians. So let me write here reptiles, fishes and amphibians. And actually birds and mammals are endothermal, because in both birds and mammals we have our inbuilt thermostat which maintains our constant internal temperature. Okay, hecistothermal is those organisms which are living in very very cold conditions. For example, those above the tundra, tree line meaning the tundra, above those which were constantly and permanently the ground is covered with snow and there is areas of heavy snow. Organisms which are living in such extreme cold conditions are said to be hecistothermals. And even warm-blooded animals show several morphological means with respect to the structure of the body and sometimes certain functional changes in the body as well, like for example in pigmentation. In colder areas, animals exhibit pale colored pigmentation. In arid climates, the pigmentation is yellowish brown to red, and the pigmentation is dark or black in humid hot areas. This is referred to as the Glauger's rule. Thermoperiodicity, change in temperature that occurs at specific interval of time. So therefore the changes which happen in temperature follow a periodic or a cyclical pattern, and that is called as thermoperiodicity. For example, diurnal thermoperiodicity. Diurnal means during day and during night. There is obviously temperature changes during daytime, the temperature is very high, and during the night time and the evening time the temperature is very low. Such changes which happen during day and night are called diurnal thermoperiodicity. Temperature changes which happen over a period of a season is referred to as seasonal periodicity. Like for example, we saw how, you know, how during the summer season the temperature is very high and during the winter season the temperature drops. Such temperature fluctuations which last for an entire season are referred to as seasonal periodicity. They favor different aspects of plant and animal life. For example, you can say flowering, fruiting and migration, reproduction of animals are favored by different types of such fluctuations, and that is referred to as phenology. Warm-blooded animals in colder areas. Why warm-blooded animals in colder areas have larger size? So that they can decrease their surface area volume ratio, and that means they can compensate for whatever heat that they have lost. They can generate more and more heat in their body. This type of a law which says that warm-blooded organisms, of course it is based on real pattern, warm-blooded animals in cold areas have larger size, meaning they have a lesser surface area to volume ratio, is because or is a rule that is referred to as the Bergman's rule. Like I said, if there is a lower surface area to volume ratio, then the heat loss can be compensated by the enormous volume. That's why their size is very high. They have a larger size so that they can have a larger body volume. But if you take some animals which are living in polar regions, they have peripheral parts like ears, snout, tails and legs are very, very small or very, very shorter. That is because to prevent or minimize the heat loss, because in such conditions they have to preserve the body heat. If they have longer extremities like ears, snout, etc., then they're obviously going to lose a lot of heat to the surrounding. This rule is referred to as Allen's rule. Fishes of colder waters tend to have more vertebrae, and this rule is referred to as Jordan's rule. And then we have lot of other changes which animals exhibit, like for example hibernation in winter, aestivation in summer, migration during winters in northern hemisphere, which is very common, where birds migrate from northern hemisphere to southern hemisphere due to very cold conditions in winter in northern hemisphere. Auroral, that is animals which are active during early mornings, and vesperal, animals which are active during evening, during the dusk time, are some of the behavioral changes which you can see with respect to temperature changes. Actually, this also involves a component, for example, auroral and vesperal also involves a component of changes in the light intensity, because during the early morning time, the sunlight intensity is very less, and so is it during the evening times. Water. Now, water is called the elixir of life. Without water, we couldn't have imagined life. We cannot imagine life. So the fact that life is possible on our planet is because our planet is in a habitable zone in the solar system, which ensures that water occurs in its liquid form, isn't it? And how does water affect plant and animal life forms? Because water comes down to the earth as annual rainfall, and that results in different types of distribution of plants. And of course, plant distribution has a direct impact on animal distribution, isn't it? So terrestrial plants and water availability on the basis of moisture. If plants are living in wet areas, they require a lot of moisture, then they are referred to as hydrophytes. For example, you have Ranunculus, Acluda, Rumex, Dentatus, etc., and they have to have some mechanism to get rid of excess water. So they have special water stomata on the margin of their leaves called hydathode, which gets rid of excess water in the form of water droplets. This loss of water in the form of water droplets is referred to as guttation. If plants are living in moderate water condition, moist conditions, but not too wet conditions like hydrophyte, then we call them as mesophytes. All the plants and fruits and vegetables that we see around us, we see in our day-to-day life, are mostly mesophytes, because they are neither living in wet nor in dry conditions. They're living in moderate water conditions or moist habitats. And if a plant is living in dry habitats, then it is referred to as a xerophyte. You know how in xerophyte they have lot of mechanisms to prevent water loss through transpiration, like in cactus, for example. It has lost its leaf and the leaf has become reduced into spine. And how in case of cactus, the stem has become very green and succulent and performs photosynthesis and stores water also. There are a lot of xerophytic plants like acacia, tamarix, casuarina, etc. And like I said, presence of spines and thorns to prevent water loss or to check water loss by transpiration. Light, and you know that light, mostly we are concerned with visible part of light, and among that, the range which helps in photosynthesis is about 400 to 700 nanometer. This range within the visible light is referred to as the photosynthetically active radiation. Of course, we have even ultraviolet radiation and infrared radiation or heat radiations which occur within the electromagnetic spectrum. Light influences a lot of life processes. To think of a few: photosynthesis, growth, transpiration, germination, pigmentation of animals and plants also, movements of animals and plants, daily rhythm or the diurnal rhythm of animals, as well as photoperiodism, that is a specific duration of light which is required for flowering in plants, which is called photoperiodism. So you can see so many biological processes which are directly dependent on light. In plant seed, germination of the seed also depends upon light. Some of the seeds are sensitive to light. This sensitivity to light is called photoblastic seeds. If a seed is sensitive to light for its germination, then it is called photoblastic. If it germinates only in the presence of light, we call it as a positively photoblastic seed. For example, viscum and rheums. And if it does not germinate in the presence of light, then it is referred to as a negatively photoblastic succeed, for example, onion and tomato. So if it depends on light for germination, it is positively photoblastic. If it does not germinate in the presence of light, it is called negatively photoblastic. And then you know that there are so many unicellular organisms like Chlamydomonas, Euglena and Volvox. They all have chloroplast in them to manufacture food, to capture the radiant energy from the sun. So they tend to move, they tend to swim and reach areas which are well lit by light. This kind of movement or attraction towards the light is referred to as phototaxis. Plant shoots, you know that how if you keep a plant in a dark chamber and open up a window, the plant will start bending towards the light, from towards the direction of the light, and this is called phototropism. There are some movements, however, which do not follow a specific direction. They are in response to a stimulus, but they do not happen in a particular direction. That is called photonasty. For example, in the nighttime, you must have seen how the leaves of the plants droop down, and this is referred to as nictinasty. So tropism is a directed movement towards the stimulus. Nasty is not a directed movement. There is no specific direction to nastic movements. Then we have photoperiodism. I told you plants depend upon the length of daylight or length of light in another way, and darkness also, in order to flower. Accordingly, plants can be classified into short day plants and long day plants and day neutral plants during their reproductive phase, because flower or floral primordium, that is, it develops in the plant only once the plant has crossed its juvenile or vegetative phase and the plant has successfully entered its reproductive phase, isn't it? In animals, you see, animals which are active during the daytime and are not active during the nighttime are called diurnal. Animals which are active only during the nighttime, they are called nocturnal. And I had told you, animals which are active during early morning time, they are called auroral. For example, Bubalcus. Bubalcus is the cattle egret, a very common bird that you see sitting on the back of the cows grazing in the field, isn't it? So auroral means it is active at dawn or early morning. Vespiral means it is active at the darker side of twilight, that is at the dusk time or sunset, for example, rabbits. Crepuscular means it is active during the twilight period, when it's neither dark nor light, the intermediate period where the light intensity starts diminishing, that is called the twilight period. And if an animal is active during the twilight period, it is called crepuscular. For example, you have lion and some species of cockroaches. So animals have color vision, they have the ability to detect light. Of course, we have pigments in our retina which can detect light. Not only light, we can also detect color, the different parts of the visible spectrum. And it is well marked in so many organisms like fish, birds and primates. And we have different types of cones, isn't it? Cyanolabe, sensitive to blue light. Erythrolabe, sensitive to red light. And chlorolabe, that is sensitive to green light. And then there are so many animals which are completely blind. The cave salamander has lived its entire life in the cave, and therefore it has adapted to becoming blind. And then sharks are colorblind. They can see black and white images, but they are colorblind. And then if you see marine animals that are living in the deep, they have larger eyes to pick up the faintest of light signals that may reach them. Migration, animals with response to light, they migrate, they hibernate and they estivate, they show reproductive behavior. Some animals become reproductively mature during winter season, because in the winter season the day is very short. These are called short day animals. They breed during the winter, like sheep and deer. Some of the animals, they become sexually mature or they become reproductively receptive during summer season. That is because in the summer the days become longer. So long day animals like turkey and starling, and some of the animals, they become reproductively mature irrespective of whether it is a short day or a long day or a particular season. These are referred to as day neutral animals, like you have rodents and you have rabbit, guinea pig and squirrel, etc. Biological rhythm, that is daily responses to light conditions, these are also called the circadian rhythms. Circadian rhythms means it usually is a pattern or a cycle in which how an animal responds to changes in the pattern of light in the surrounding environment. For example, it is seen in insects, birds and mammals. Zooplankton show vertical distribution, that is whether you can find them in the shallow waters or whether they migrate to the deeper waters. This depends upon the fluctuation of light in the surrounding starting. Then you have the snowshoe hare that develops a white coat when the days start becoming smaller and smaller, that is decreasing photoperiod. The days start becoming shorter and shorter, they start developing white coat. Animals in the caves, because they are not exposed to too much light, they show lower metabolism, they become very, very sluggish and lethargic. And light increases enzymatic activity, it stimulates certain biochemical processes such as photosynthesis and respiration. Phenology, like I told you, animals exhibit timing of seasonal activity, and mostly they time their seasonal activity, not only animals, in plants also. If you see animals, they migrate during specific time of the year depending upon the length of the daylight, for example. Or you can see how in plants the flowering is, again, the flowering is spaced accordingly, whether it is a short day condition or a long day condition. So when an organism times its activity according to the conditions of light, according to the cycles of fluctuations of light happening in the surrounding environment, then it is referred to as phenology. Like, for example, birds start migrating in the northern hemisphere when days start becoming shorter over there. They get an idea that winter is coming, so they need to migrate to the southern hemisphere. So they modify their behavior, they modify their lifestyle, they modify their migratory habits or their seasonal activities depending upon changes which happen in light intensity. That is what is referred to as phenology. In plants, you can see leaf fall and dormancy, which occur during temperate and subtropical areas. As the days start becoming short, as we start approaching the autumn season, you can see how they start shedding off their leaves. The fall season, that is specifically just before the winter in the temperate region, fall is very, very clearly demarcated. So during the fall season, they start shedding their leaves. And how animals, they start getting into a deep slumber called winter sleep. These are ectothermic animals, which cannot regulate their own body temperature. They are also called cold-blooded animals. So how do they overcome that condition of extreme cold? By getting into a deep sleep or a deep slumber, that is called hibernation. And I have already discussed about how flowering changes or flowering pattern is altered depending upon the length of day and the length of night, isn't it? We have also seen some vegetative storage organs, vegetative growth, like, for example, tubers and root tubers and corm and rhizome, etc. They are basically, the growth of such vegetative structures is favored by short day conditions, like in potato, dahlia, artichoke and radish, while in some plants it is favored by long day conditions, like in onion and garlic. Animal breeding, like in case of turkeys and ferrets and starling, they breed in response to lengthening of days, and goat, sheep and deer in response to shortening, and rabbit and guinea pigs are day neutral. I told you that during a particular season, depending upon the length of the day, their breeding behavior is altered. They become receptive for the process of reproduction. So therefore, you can see how the days, the light can also alter the animal breeding process, isn't it? And what exactly is the soil? Now, moving on to after water and temperature and light, we are now moving on to soil. Now, soil is mostly the weathered part of the rock. So basically, the weathering or the breaking of the rock and into a fine powder that is referred to as the soil, is mostly formed by a process that is called pedogenesis. It can be brought forth by atmospheric changes, mechanical forces, chemical changes and biological breakdown. So please remember, the weathering of the mineral matter, which is changed to soil, is happening by a process that is referred to as pedogenesis. The science dealing with the study of soil is called pedology. It involves humification, formation of humus, alluviation, washing down. Some of the nutrients get drained out by water as the water seeps in into the soil, that is called alluviation. And alluviation is when all these salts that are carried by the water seeping down, they are stored in the deeper parts of the soil, and that is referred to as alluviation. And then transported soils are brought to places. If soil is brought to a place by gravity, it is called colluvial oil. If running water, like say a flood, brings in soil, it is called alluvial soil. If wind carries soil, it is called aeolian soil, and if it is carried by glacier, it is called the glacial soil. What are the different types of organic matter that fall on the soil? If it is undecomposed, if it has just fallen down, say a leaf or a twig that has just fallen down, or say a dead body of an animal that is lying around on the forest floor, it is referred to as the litter. If it has undergone partial decomposition, it is called duff. If it has undergone complete decomposition, it is referred to as humus. Humus contains a lot of organic matter and roughly about 50 to 60% carbon, 35 to 40% oxygen, 5% hydrogen and 5% nitrogen. What are the different soil types? We told you, we all discussed about the colluvial, alluvial, aeolian and other types of soil. Now, if a soil does not have clear-cut horizons, when you take a section of the soil, if you don't see different zones in it, it is referred to as an azonal soil. It is also considered to be immature soil, like for example, a desert soil or the slope soil. Even in the case of the soil deposited by a river stream or by a flood, which is called alluvial soil, where you don't see those zones, that is called the azonal soil. Zonal soil is called the residual soil, because a zonal soil, if you cut open the, if you take a section of, or if you dig a region and if you see this, the cut part of the soil layers, you can see very clearly distinct horizons. It is called residual soils because it develops at that point, at that site itself. Something which develops at that site is called in situ, and it forms from the parent rock by constant, what we discuss, leaching or mineral leaching process or weathering process that happens, which is referred to as pedogenesis. Then we have different types of soil. We have red soil rich in iron and aluminium. Then these are the soils that are formed through a process of laterization. During laterization, what happens is silica dissolves and leachates are, and usually the silica content of the soil is pushed underground because it is carried by the rainwater down, or whatever water is being, say even if it is too routinely irrigated, then the water can carry away all these silica downwards, and but only leaves behind iron and aluminium. Such kind of soils which are rich in iron and aluminium are called laterite soils. Then we have black soils, which are dark brown or black in color, and they have a good quantity of organic matter in them. The soil contains a lot of clay or hydrated silicates of iron and aluminium. They are locally called riggers or black cotton soils. I told you that alluvial soil is transported by water bodies like flowing water, like a flood, or it may be a river or a sea. And then if you see the soil that mostly occurs in the foothills of mountains and smaller hills, we refer to it as the terrace soil. And then you can say they're mostly made up of rocky particles. These rocky particles, they get broken off from the mountain and they slip along the slope by gravity and rain wash, and they get deposited in the base or the foothill of the mountain. And such soils are also referred to as colluvial because they did come down because of the influence of gravity, and well-drained colluvial soils are highly fertile. Okay. So soil composition is mineral matter of 40%, organic matter of 10%, very less organic matter if you see. Soil moisture is 25%, soil atmosphere is 25%, and soil organisms are always variable. How much of the soil is occupied by pore spaces is referred to as soil porosity. The maximum porosity is seen in a well-manured loamy soil. Then 50% pore spaces are seen in clay soil, 40% porosity in loamy soil, and very few, that is 30%, is referred to as in the sandy soil. There are two types of pores or spaces that you see in the soil. Some are called micropores and some are called macropores. If it's a micropore, it has a diameter less than about 20 micrometer, and most importantly, it can hold water in these spaces. The water that is held in these spaces that are available for absorption by plants is referred to as capillary water. If it is a macropore, it has a diameter of more than 20 micrometer, and these spaces called macropores, pores between the soil particles hold what in them? They mostly hold air in them, isn't it? Then larger size macropores, which are greater than 50 micrometer, they mostly take part in percolation of water in the soil. They are the ones which allow the water to seep through the soil layers and get collected in the groundwater aquifers. Okay, that is what we call the groundwater table, isn't it? So if there are larger size pores like macropores, they can allow water to seep through into the groundwater aquifers. Soil air is the oxygen that is trapped in the soil. In a good soil, about 25% of the total volume should be filled with air. It is more carbon dioxide than oxygen because it is not that directly in contact with the surface atmosphere, and it is very, very important for the root and soil organisms because roots also respire aerobically, so they obviously need a lot of oxygen to function. Soil pH. In alkaline soils, there is a pH of greater than 7. There's a reduced availability of zinc, manganese and iron because of the very high pH. In acidic soil, there is abundance of iron, manganese and aluminium, but there's deficiency of calcium, magnesium and potassium. Certain soils may have lot of salts in them, like in sodium and magnesium may be excess, and that is in the case of saline soils. One of the dangers of excessive irrigation is that when you water the plants too much, the water will stay on the soil for a longer time. It will stand on the soil and it will extract all the salts from the soil, forming a thin crust of soil on the surface of the soil, and that increases the soil salinity. What are various adaptations exhibited by animals? Animals can regulate. Now, if you don't want your temperature to change with the surrounding environment, you will maintain a constant temperature. That is called regulate. But fishes, amphibians, and reptiles cannot do that. They will conform, meaning their body temperature will be in accordance to the outside temperature. Or if they cannot do, or if they think that it is beyond their limit of tolerance, the best thing they can do is leave a hostile place and go to a less hostile space. That is called migrate, or sometimes their developmental activities or their metabolic activities may slow down and they can enter into a state of suspension. What are some of the phenotypic adaptations? Now, phenotypic adaptations may occur with response to specific environmental changes. There may be changes which occur in the shape or the structure of the body, that is called morphology or functioning of the body. This kind of phenotypic plasticity is seen in plants. Like, for example, in plants, some of the plants which live in water, their leaves above the water will have a different type of structure and the leaves below the water will have a different type of structure. This is called phenotypic plasticity. The phenotype variants among the population are referred to as ecophenes or ecads. So those organisms belonging to the same population, but they may exhibit certain variation in their phenotype because they are subjected to different environmental conditions, are referred to as ecophenes or ecads. Genotypic adaptation. Sometimes even their genetic material gets modified because of the changes happening in the surrounding environment. A species with a long range may have such subpopulations which are genetically slightly different, called ecotype. Say, for example, a species of plant is distributed over a vast stretch of field, and then the field is continuing, and then suddenly there is a stream, and suddenly there is a shady area, suddenly there is an open field where there's a lot of sunlight, and suddenly the field extends above the hill. So at every stretch of this field, the plants exhibit certain genetic variations in them, although they belong to the same population and although they can interbreed among themselves. And such changes which occur within the members of a particular population, but because they are subjected to different environmental conditions, because they develop certain genetic modifications, is referred to as ecotypes. Plant adaptations. You know that those which love to live in this, which love a lot of sunlight, are called heliophytes, and those which cannot tolerate too much of sunlight, which love shade, are called as scyophytes. Also, the number of chloroplast. If you see, mostly the upper surface of the leaves have lot of chloroplast, but the chloroplast is oriented in the direction of sunlight so that there is the intensity of the light doesn't become too much. But in shaded plants, if you see the chloroplast, the longer axis of the chloroplast is at right angles to the incident light, so that they can get maximum sunlight that is falling onto the leaf, because first of all the plant is living in a shade. And then if you see in diffuse light, that is when light is neither intense nor it is less intense, if it's of moderate intensity, then you can see that the chloroplasts become distributed evenly. Then you have xerophytes, are plants which live in dry regions. Halophytes are those plants which live in extremely saline conditions. Samophytes live in sandy soil. Chasmophytes live in sandy rock crevices. You can see plants emerging from crevices of rocks as well. Oxalophytes are those which live in acidic soils. Calcophytes are those which live in calcium-rich soils. Plant adaptations to those soils which are very poor in nutrient. If a soil is poor in nutrient, we call it as oligotrophic. Then you know that the roots of these plants have special symbiotic association with fungal hyphae. Such association between fungal hyphae and the root of higher plants is referred to as mycorrhiza. If the mycorrhiza develops inside the plant cell, it is called endomycorrhiza. If it is present outside the plant cell or tissue, it is called ectomycorrhiza. In endomycorrhiza, the fungal partner is a zygomycete. In ectomycorrhiza, the fungal partner is a basidiomycete. So basically, the mycorrhiza give the plant, they form extensive networks in the soil, networks of hyphae, and they give the plant root a lot of phosphorus and lot of mineral nutrients, and also they help the plant root to absorb water because they form an extensive network which spreads over great lengths in the soil, and the plant in turn gives them organic food and shelter to live. Okay, so it is a mutualistic relationship. In animals, they exhibit migration. How do animals exhibit adaptations? They may migrate daily, sometimes during winter or summer season. When the conditions become inhospitable or hostile, they start migrating in looking for better areas where the conditions are bearable. Sometimes there are periodic migrations, like see, you can see a golden plover is a migrant, which is a migrant bird in India during the winter season, and see how it flies non-stop for 3600 kilometer. So periodic migrations may be there, may be large populations which migrate mostly in search of food and in various directions. Cooperative interactions, like for example mating interaction. Now basically cooperation is involved, or cooperation within the members of a species, within the members of a population, is very, very important for the continuation of the species, and it's required for purposes such as mating. And before mating, there is the courtship behavior where the male and the female check their compatibility. It is seen in birds and insects. And after the mating process, the female has to take care of her eggs. Like in cockroaches, the female cockroach constructs an egg case called utike, and so many other organisms. Like if you see seahorses, the male seahorse collects the young ones from the mother, the eggs from the mother, and takes care of it in its brood pouch. So it literally gives birth to young ones. Midwife toad that carries the eggs of the female in the brood pouch, isn't it? So basically these are interactions which are seen within members of the same population where there is a lot of cooperation. Okay. Group formation, they usually form groups for protection or for breeding process. For example, tigers, owls and spiders, individuals can come together only during the process of mating. Dominance, sometimes some members of a particular population are dominant, like for example the young ones are also subordinate to the adults, and the females are also subordinate to the male, with exception the males occupy a dominant position, like in a lion pride and an elephant herd. Communication, now organisms may communicate with each other through scents, which are referred to as pheromone, mostly in insects. Now in animals like monkeys and birds, there may be communication through touch, that is tactile. In some cases, there may be communication by making sounds, like in the case of auditory communication. Or in honeybees, like we saw that there is waggle dance, which can tell the honeybees the direction of the source of nectar and pollen. Then there is society formation. We have seen this in eusocial insects, where a lot of members come together and they associate with one another. There is division of labor. For example, there is a society of honeybee with a clear hierarchy, that is queen occupies the topmost position, and then the fertile drones, which are haploid, and then the sterile workers, the sterile females are the workers which work very hard for the well-being of the honeybee colony. Altruism is where one particular organism sacrifices itself for the other members of the population. For example, in the case of spotted deer, the old and the weak members come and surround the male which has the best antlers. So they want to put their life at risk to protect some other member of the population. So this kind of a sacrificial act is referred to as altruism, exhibited by some organisms. Territoriality, you know how animals mark their territory, isn't it? Like for example, tigers and dogs, they urinate to mark their territory, and in rabbits there is anal glands which produce a pheromone like secretion or some scent like secretion which will tell the other rabbits that this is the particular territory that belongs to a particular organism. So territoriality is also another cooperative interaction that is seen to prevent overlapping of population and to prevent undue competition. If there is too many organisms organisms living in a particular area, then the raw materials also may get exhausted. In that sense, we can consider territoriality as a means of cooperation. Camouflage, as you can know, it is a desperate attempt made by an animal in order to go completely unnoticed from a predator in order to protect itself or in order to overcome aggression. So in this, the organism blends with the surroundings. So for example, you have a leaf like a grasshopper that looks exactly like the leaf, so you cannot spot it when it is sitting on the tree, or a praying mantis, which is very, very, you have seen that it is green in color, it blends very easily with the surrounding foliage. Echolocation, adaptation in case of nocturnal animals which do not have a good eyesight. They produce high frequency sound waves or ultrasound which hit a particular obstacle and it gets reflected back, and these organisms can on that basis can identify the distance, the approximate distance of that obstacle, and this is referred to as echolocation. Diapause, where there is suspension or dormancy of certain zooplanktons in development and larvae of some insects. Now, because of the conditions in the surrounding environment have become unfavorable, their activities get suspended in this process referred to as diapause. Hibernation, as you all know, hibernation is seen in cold-blooded organisms or ectotherms like in case of bears, and aestivation is also the summer sleep that is seen in the case of animals like frog. Basically, hibernation is winter sleep and aestivation is summer sleep. Aquatic adaptation in animals, there is change in the body shape, they become streamlined, there's no neck, there's loss of head mobility, some of the neck vertebrae fuse together, and you of course know there are paddles and fins that are present on the body which will help them to navigate in the aquatic environment. Then you have certain swim bladders. Swim bladders will act as a balancing organ or a hydrostatic organ, and then it will help them. Certain osmoregulatory mechanisms, like in unicellular forms, there is presence of contractile vacuole, and freshwater fishes have larger glomeruli to produce more hydrated urine in them, and marine fishes have special cells in their gills called inosites which excrete unwanted and excess salt. So maintenance of salt and water balance in the body is nothing but referred to as osmoregulation. How do animals cope with reduced water conditions, that is water scarcity? Like for example, if you take a kangaroo rat seldom drinks water and has a thick coat to prevent water loss. It doesn't even have sweat glands, and it sometimes meets its water requirement by breaking down fat, and this water that is obtained by breaking down reserve food material is referred to as metabolic water. And if you take a population, how a population increases in its size or how it is maintained in its size, when new organisms are added to the population, it is because of birth of new individuals. This birth rate is called natality. If organisms are removed from a population, it is due to the death rate, the death or the elimination of organisms called mortality. And then sometimes organisms may move in from the neighboring populations, so it adds to the population density. If you remove the existing members, if they leave the population and go to some other population, then it results in elimination, which is referred to as emigration or immigration. So natality adds to the population density, mortality removes from the population density, similarly immigration adds to the population density, and emigration or emigration removes from the population density. And then there is an expression for the growth of a population with respect to time. So the growth of a population can be expressed as nt is equal to n naught plus birth plus immigration minus death plus immigration. So it should be death plus immigration. So nt is the final population rate at growth rate or size or density at time t is equal to 0, and this is the initial time t is equal to 0, and birth plus immigration, they add to the population. So you are subtracting the things which eliminate from the population, that is death plus immigration, you are subtracting it from birth plus immigration. There are growth models which say that geometrically sometimes the population can grow, geometric population explosion, or something which is not theoretically possible actually, because nature and natural resources become limiting at a certain point. You can see this dashed line over here. This represents the maximum limit to which the environment can hold a population, and that is what is referred to as environmental resistance. But here you can see the mathematical expression for a population which is just rising rising up like this because there is nobody to put a brake against it. So since this is something which is more realistic, it is called the realistic population growth curve, where there is a limit up to which a population can increase in its size, and that limit is referred to as the environmental resistance. And then according to the age pyramid and the sex ratio, you have organisms belonging to the pre-reproductive age, organisms which are reproductively active, and organisms which are belonging to the post-reproductive age. And when you consider sex ratio, it is the ratio of the number of male individuals to the number of female individuals in a particular population. Then if you talk about population interactions, how organisms of a particular species or of a different species interact with each other, there may be a positive interaction between them, which where one of them either dominate, one of them either benefits from the interaction, the other one neither benefits nor is it harmed, or if they are harmed from this kind of interaction, then it is called a negative interaction, okay? Predation is where one of them is benefited and the other one is harmed, isn't it? The predators are benefited while the prey which the predator preys upon is killed, and as a result the preys lose out on their life. So basically predation is seen in most of the heterotrophic organisms because they cannot manufacture their own food by capturing the radiant energy from the sunlight. Or in other animals like herbivores, carnivores, with exception of scavengers, and some plants are also insectivorous, like you know about Nepenthes, and you also have Drosera, etc., and they feed on other insects, so they are also considered to be predatory plants. Insectivorous plants, I was telling you, bladderwort, dionea or Venus flytrap, Drosera or sundew plant, Nepenthes or pitcher plant, all of these feed on insects, and they are known to be phytophagous, that is feeding on insects. Insects are also known to be phytophagous. Now these plants which I just mentioned are referred to as insect or you can say predatory plants. They are called predatory plants, insectivorous plants, because they feed on insects. What about insects themselves? Insects themselves are known to be phytophagous, meaning about 25% of all the insects feed on plant juices. They are called phytophagous. So that way, who becomes the predator here? The insect becomes the predator, isn't it? Then, how does a plant overcome such predators? By developing thorns, spines, prickles and bristles, like in Zizipus, Argimon, Opuntia and Urtica. Then sometimes there is formation of sticky glandular hair, which will prevent these insects from coming and colonizing the surface of the plant body in Cleom and Nephalium. And then there may be some behavioral changes which may be seen in case of some plants. They harbor ants for protecting themselves against herbivores. See, so that the ant can sting the herbivore if the herbivore is trying to eat the plant, isn't it? In South American plant Acacia spirocephala, the stipules are modified into hollow spines in order to shelter the ants, so the ants will protect them from the grazing herbivores, which are the predators in this particular case. Chemical is, if a plant is bitter to taste, offensive in smell, and irritating substances if it contains, then obviously the predator will not try to prey upon or will not try to feed upon such a plant, isn't it? And some plants like calotropis and tannins, latex and alkaloids, they have poisonous cardiac glycosides in them. Then you have competition. It is rivalry between two or more organisms. So competition is for the same food resources that we can see. It may be between the members of the same species, or it may be between the members of different species. And this is the basis for the Darwinian struggle for existence and survival of fittest, based upon which his theory of natural selection is based upon. So when two or more organisms are fighting with each other for a common resource, then it is referred to as competition. It may be between two different species, it is called interspecific. If it happens within the same species, then competition is referred to as intraspecific competition. Like I said, if competition happens within the same species, it is referred to as intraspecific, more because it happens for a common resource. Because the two organisms belong to the same species, they want to depend on the same resource, and therefore there is competition for it. Some organisms show reduced natality when density decreases. Now some of them, their density decreases because of the competition. They're not able to stand up to the one that is competing with them, so they become competitively weak species. species, isn't it? And some also start establishing their own territories in their home range in order to start pushing out the competitive species. So they want to get rid of any kind of competition in their vicinity. There is a hypothesis called the Gauss's hypothesis. He had studied that when two members of a species of Paramecium are grown together, the weaker one gets completely eliminated, and this is called Gauss's hypothesis. It is also called the principle of competitive exclusion. Always remember, when there is competition between two members of the same species or between two different species, the competitively weaker one gets eliminated. That's why it is called, or it gets excluded. That's why it is called the principle of competitive exclusion. Mimicry. Now, organisms can modify in their form, structure and behavior or color so that they resemble another organism. They mimic another organism. There can be protective mimicry, aggressive mimicry, conscious mimicry. For example, let us see protective mimicry. They can mimic say for example, an insect mimicking a leaf. For example, you have leaf insects like Phyllium, and an insect surprisingly mimics a twig or a stick. And then there is a butterfly which looks like a dead leaf, that is Callima. So this is called protective or concealing type of mimicry. So by looking like some of these structures, they can prevent themselves from being captured by the predator. So this is called protective or concealing type of mimicry. Warning type of mimicry, not concealing type, not to escape from the predator, but warn the predator. Like for example, if one of them is a palatable butterfly, but it resembles the distasteful one, then it is called as Batesian mimicry. If both of them are distasteful or unpalatable and they happen to look like each other, then it is referred to as Mullerian mimicry. Like in the case of Viceroy butterfly, it is called Batesian mimicry, where the distasteful one is mimicked by the other one, which is actually the palatable one, which is not distasteful. But when both of them which mimic each other happen to be distasteful, then it is referred to as Mullerian mimicry. Like for example, the queen butterfly resembles the monarch butterfly. Aggressive mimicry, like for example, employed by the predator to catch the prey. Like in the case of concealing mimicry, like praying mantis, you can see how praying mantis puts across a myriad number of postures, isn't it, to try to destroy the prey, to try to capture the prey. This is called as concealing aggressive mimicry. And even in the case of sargassum fish, which gets blended with the algal seaweeds that are present, and it surprisingly attacks the prey. So it is called concealing aggressive mimicry. Sometimes there is alluring, attracting a prey. For example, a spider which resembles an orchid. So the insect will move towards the orchid thinking that it is a beautiful flower and in expectation of a reward, but then it ends up getting captured by the spider. Conscious mimicry. Conscious mimicry is to conquer death, feigning death or conquering death when danger confronts them from predators. For example, if suddenly a beetle, a tenebrinoid beetle, if it is threatened, it will roll into a pebble-like or a small ball-like structure which looks like a stone pebble, and the predator will think it is a non-living object and it will run away from it, or it will just ignore it. This kind of a mimicry seen by such beetles where they resemble a stone pebble is called conscious mimicry. Parasitism, as you know, a parasitism is an organism that lives off directly from another organism, which is called host. It obtains food from its host. Ectoparasites are those which live on the surface of the host body. Endoparasites are those which live inside the host body. Temporary hosts are those which temporarily the parasite comes and makes contact with the host, feeds and leaves the host. Permanent parasites which remain completely inside the body for a long, long duration until and unless efforts are made to eliminate them, like in the case of roundworm and the amoebiasis causing pathogen, that is entamoeba. Holoparasites means they entirely, completely depend on the host plant. For example, there are plants which cannot absolutely photosynthesize, like Rafflesia, Cuscuta. And if they are partially dependent on the host, then they are referred to as hemiparasites. Some of the parasites are dependent only on the stem. They are called stem parasites. Some of them feed only on the root tissue. They are referred to as the root parasites. Pathogenic and non-pathogenic parasites. Non-pathogenic parasites, they obtain food from the host, but they do not cause any disease in the host. But in pathogenic, they harm the host extensively by causing a disease and ultimately leading to the death of the host. A hyperparasite is a parasite of a parasite. For example, virus itself is a parasite on bacteria. Say, for example, virus is a parasite on an animal cell. And there is a bacteria is a parasite on an animal cell. And there is a virus which is a parasite on the bacteria. What do you call such viruses which attack bacteria? We call them as bacteriophages. And then there is the Cincinnobolus cesti, which is a powdery mildew, which is a fungus. There are bacteria like Pasteurella pestis, which is actually a parasite on another vector that transmits plague, which is called Xenopsylla cheopis, which in turn is an ectoparasite on rats. So when a parasite has a parasite of its own, then we refer to it as a hyperparasite. Amensalism. In amensalism, what happens is there are two species which are interacting with each other. One of them is inhibited, one of them is influenced in a negative way, where the other one is neutral, is neither benefited nor harmed. It is very unfair because A and B are interacting with each other. A is neither benefited nor harmed, but sadly B is harmed. Why is B harmed over here? The one that is harmed is referred to as, or it is because the species which harms the other releases certain chemicals which are referred to as the allochemicals. Okay, so please remember, the one that harms, say for example A is harming B, then A is called an inhibitor, isn't it? It is a phenomenon by which living beings do not allow other organisms to flourish nearby because they release certain chemicals which are called allochemicals which destroy the other. For example, you have penicillium. Penicillium is produced by a fungus. So fungus releases a chemical called penicillium which kills the bacteria. So fungus is harming the bacteria, but the fungus is neither benefited nor is it harmed. Similarly, trichoderma inhibits the growth of another fungus called aspergillus. So one is called an inhibitor, one is called an amensal. The one who is negatively influenced, the one who is being treated unfairly is the amensal, the one who is treating unfairly is the inhibitor. Okay, then we have positive interactions in which you have commensalism and mutualism. In commensalism, one of them is benefited, the other one does not derive any direct benefit nor is it harmed. For example, there is a fish called pilot fish, which is called the Nocrites, which swims around along with the shark. The shark is neither benefited nor is it harmed, but the fish which is swimming along with the shark can take or can catch falling pieces of food that is falling off from the mouth of the shark when it is feeding. So the fish is benefited, but the shark is neither benefited nor harmed. In mutualism, both are benefited. It is a positive interaction where both the species are mutually benefited. And the first type of mutualism is where they can live without each other. Species A and species B are living together. They both are benefited and they can live without each other. Then it is called proto-cooperation. And like, for example, the red-billed oxpecker and the yellow-billed oxpecker, which sits on the back of certain animals, like for example, the yellow-billed oxpecker sits on the back of rhinoceros and it feeds on the ticks and other parasites sticking onto the skin. The latter is relieved of the parasite. So the rhinoceros is happy that it is getting rid of parasites on its skin, and the bird is happy that it is getting its food. So both of them are mutually benefited, but they can live without each other. But when two species are interacting with each other, where both of them are benefited and one cannot survive without the other, then it is referred to as symbiosis. So symbiosis is a very close relationship where the relationship is so strong that both are benefited and one cannot survive without the other. So for example, in lichens and in nitrogen fixation, we have learned how rhizobium can fix nitrogen only in association with root nodules, otherwise it is aerobic, isn't it? And you also have root nodules in non-leguminous plants like alder and casuarina, and leaf nodules in Artemisia, and coleroid roots of cycas and water fern Azolla that helps in fixing nitrogen. So with this, we complete the synopsis of the chapter, Organisms and Populations. Thank you.